Swagorika, this module 19 is the last module in the subject matter of factorial designs. As I said, here we have two sets of information. One is the defining sets, other is the formation of key blocks. And then one is supposed to match the two. If this is the key block, what is the defining set? If this is the defining set, what is the key block? And that refers to more than two blocks in a confounded factorial experiment. So there are interesting implications coming up of the two sets that are given. So that is more or less the subject matter of what is coming up now in module number 19. And this is the last module on factorial designs. After that, we will pass on to one last topic for the modules 20, 21 and 22. So, Sagarika, as background information, we have, as you can see, we have plans 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, mostly in the form of key blocks. So, plan 1, for example, as we can see, it involves at least three factors, because we can see A, B and C, there could be some more, at least three factors. And you have the key block means the one is always there, all the factors are at zero level. So like that, we have 1, A, B, A, C, B, C, and plan 2 and so on. The plan 7, it has got a key block formation of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 8 factorial level combinations are there in the key block, like that. So we have got 8 of them as plans, and on the other side we have the defining sets. There are 8 defining sets, each one is involving I equal to this, I equal to this, etc. Sometimes I have defining set 2, A equal to BC. To convert it into I equal to something, you multiply by A on both sides. That means A square equal to ABC, A square becomes I. Because we are referring to factors at two levels, so A square becomes identity. Like that, B equal to AC, you multiply both sides by B, it becomes I equal to ABC. C equal to AB, you multiply both sides by C, C square equal to ABC, that means I equal to ABC. And then we have I equal to ABCD, etc. So we have a set of plans in terms of the key blocks and a set of defining sets. Now we have to definitely, I'm sure, we have to make some kind of correspondence between the two sets. Let's see what is coming up in terms of the exercise. So question 1 says, you have a 2 cube factorial experiment in two blocks with the interaction effect ABC confounded. Then the key block is given by etc. You have the plans over there. You find out the key block for confounding the interaction effect ABC, and then you match with the options that are given over here, either 1 or 2 or 3 or none of the above. Okay? You have a 2 cube factorial experiment in two blocks with two factor interaction effect AB confounded. If AB is confounded, we know that it should look like A minus 1, B minus 1, C plus 1. You have got 4 and 4, and you know the formation of the key block. You have to match with all these things and then come up with the right answers. So it says that you have a 2 cube factorial experiment and the key block is given by plan number 3. Now you are given the key block formation. You have to find out which confounded effect or interaction is represented by this. That's the question here. Here again you are given the key block as plan number 5, then you have to find out which effect and interaction is confounded. This refers to plan number 7, okay. This refers to plan number 8. So they are taking up, looks like taking up one or two. Consider a 2 to the power 4 conducted in 4 blocks, confounding the effects and interactions A, B, C, D, and their generalized interaction A, B, C, D. Now what is the key block? So it is 2 to the power 4, that means there are 16 level combinations, but because it is conducted in 4 blocks, every block has got size 4. Therefore, the key block also will have size 4. That's why all the plans, if you recall, all the plans, they have got size 4 like that. Okay. So now we have to find out which one is the key block if A, B, C, D and A, B, C, D have been confounded. So the idea is for A, B, A minus 1, B minus 1, C plus 1, D plus 1. That gives 8 and 8. For C, D, A plus 1, B plus 1, C minus 1, D minus 1. That again gives 8. You crisscross them, you get 4, 4, 4, 4. Identify the key block and match with the solutions that are given. This time again they are talking about 2 to the power 4, 4 blocks, the effects that may be confounded. It's a tricky question. So as you know, if there are 4 blocks, 3 effects will be confounded, but 2 of them are independent, the third one is their generalized interaction. So all that we have to sort out it. Are we talking about totally 3 independent, then that will be not possible, that will be impossible. A, B, A, D, their generalized interaction is B, D, therefore that is possible. A, B, C, D, generalized interaction is A, B, C, D, therefore B is not true. A, B, C, A, B, D, that is also not true. So A, B, A, D, B, D, that is the right choice. If at all we want to confound, yes, all the 3, A, B, A, D, and B, D, they may be confounded. But that will be a very bad design because you are confounding many two-factor interactions. What does it say? Read it, please.
Sir, in a 2 to the power 4 factorial experiment, here we are planning to confound the interactions ACBD and their interaction ABCD. Then we need to start.
We call it generalized interaction.
Okay, sir. Here is the generalized interaction. Then we need to start with 2 sets of blocks arising out of the defining set given by I is equal to AC is equal to BD and these options.
Yeah. So if I look at the first one, AC, BD, and that is what we want, and as a byproduct, ABCD will come. The second option, ABC and D, the byproduct is okay, ABCD, but the individual ones are not matching with what we want. Okay, and similarly the third one. So the generalized interaction is ABCD no matter how you look at it. But the two components, the two constituent elements, they don't quite conform to what we want.
Okay.
Therefore only one A is the right answer.
Okay. So in order to give a plan for a confounded 2 to the power 4 factorial experiment in 4 blocks of equal size, the defining set of the form I is equal to ABC is equal to ABD, this is formed.
Okay.
Then the confounded interactions are likely to be which of the of these 4?
If we have ABC, ABD, their generalized interaction is CD. So we know straight away what are the 3 interactions that are being confounded. ABC, ABD and CD. ABC, ABD, ABCD wrong, ABC, ABD and CD right, ABCD and ABCD wrong. So B is the correct answer.
Okay. So here we are referring to question number 10.
Now let's go back again. So this is the question, I equal to ABC equal to ABD, generalized interaction CD. We have to find out the key block. For ABC I know A minus 1, B minus 1, C minus 1, D plus 1, split into 8 and 8. ABD A minus 1, B minus 1, C plus 1, D minus 1, split into 8 and 8, superimpose one on the other, and then get cells of 4, 4, 4, 4, identify the key block, and match with the result that is given in question 11. Okay.
Question 11, yes.
The key block. What is the key block? You know, it's not a straightforward question.
In 2 cube factorial experiment conducted in 2 blocks, the confounded interaction is obtained from the defining set.
So we know the defining set, therefore we know which interaction has been confounded.
Yes. Now this means that the key block will be formed of which of the following 4 options?
What does the first option say? What does it say?
The first option says one of the components in each of the defining sets 1 to 4.
Okay. So let's try to understand 2 cube experiment conducted in 2 blocks. Confounded interaction obtained from the defining set 1 given on the top. So we know exactly which one is being confounded there. So that is known. This means that the key block will be formed. So we already have an idea about the key block coming from defining set 1. Now they are saying, is it the same as 1 coming from one of the components of all the 4 defining sets? It said it is coming from defining set 1. Is it also coming from 2, coming from 3, coming from 4? That's the whole idea. What is the next option?
Only the LHS component,
left-hand side component
in each of the defining sets 1 to 4.
Okay.
Then the next one is the level combinations obtained after expanding this thing. And using all 4 with plus signs.
Let's try to understand. The moment I say A minus 1, B minus 1, C minus 1, I'm confounding ABC. and then the terms with the plus sign is A, B, C, A, B, and C. That is the thing coming up here. And they want to know if this is the same as the key block that was referred to under defining set 1. Okay, that's the kind of question.
Here in a 2-cube factorial experiment again, which is conducted in 2 blocks,
right,
the confounded interaction is obtained from the defining set given in 1.
Okay.
This means that the key block will be formed of...
Okay, almost the same type as question number 12. Absolutely. Okay.
So we can...
So you know the defining set 1. We know what is the interaction that has been confounded. We know what are the key block formation. And then we have to see, that means that the key block will be formed of, etc., etc., etc. There are all kinds of options given. The interesting thing is that they are trying to understand if beyond defining set 1, there are other sets which also qualify to give confounding of the same effect. Okay. That's the interesting part. Okay.
Question number 14. Here again, it's 2-cube factorial experiment conducted in 2 blocks, and the confounded interaction is obtained from the defining set 1 as it had been given. So this means that the key block will be formed of
the analogous type of thing.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. Yes.
Okay.
So here is the next one.
Okay.
In a 2-cube factor, same
again,
thing.
Same thing. Defining set 1, the key block formation will be like this. It's interesting. So how do you think about the whole collection of questions? All kinds of questions, even though we are dealing at very elementary level, but vast and varied number of questions, all in the form of MCQ, taking up, you know, addressing the basic questions of confounding, and then fractional replication, and then blocking, and then ANOVA, and then errors, and then which estimates and effects can, which effects and interactions can be estimated, which cannot be estimated, all kinds of things going on.
Yes.
Here so is the end kind of.
It's absolutely a splendid experience to be a part of it, sir.
So I hope you have the, you didn't have any idea about how MCQs can come up in factorial designs,
yes,
okay?
Yes. So
because we always study and learn the basic techniques and we solve long questions, we never realize that there is so much of beauty in this topic.
Yes, sir.
It's simply an amazing thing. It definitely should help in thorough understanding and eliminating all your doubts, you know.
It can be a good recapitulation as well.
Recapitulation, my purpose was to make it as a recapitulation. There's an underlying story behind it.
Okay.
One of my revered professors, Professor S.P. Mukherjee of Calcutta University, he once approached me saying that because you are a design expert and I have some students who are preparing themselves for some qualifying exam, in that they have a design module, and that module involves factorial designs, etc. And then there has already been a course given to all these students who are aspiring to sit for the exam. But the course was given about 6 months back.
Okay.
It covered CRD, RBD, LSD, factorial, etc., confounding, etc. So they already had a course on this thing given by one faculty in ISI.
Okay.
But can you recapitulate? I thought, oh, that's a very good idea. Once they have been told about all these things, I don't have to go for any formal lecturing. Why don't I try to take it up in the form of MCQ?
Okay.
So I remember, it's about 3-4 years back, in one evening, I sat and I could frame 200 MCQ questions.
At a time.
I just sat around 6 o'clock in the evening till about 11 o'clock at night, and I could frame almost 200 questions on MCQ. I was amazed seeing the capacity of myself. How could I do it? How could I generate? How could I generate so many questions and so many options? Okay, but eventually I was able to do it. It is a big store for me, and I have handed it over to all my design theorist friends, including some people in the Calcutta University faculty, Professor Nipesh Mandol, in ISI, Professor G.M. Shaha, and others. You know, wherever I go, I make it a point to give an expository talk on factorial experiments using my MCQs, and people everywhere, they appreciate my efforts. I hope that it will go okay with the students. Okay. The one last topic will come in the next 3 modules that will take up the response surface methodology.
Okay.
That is not usually taught in undergraduate, and I have not aspired to give a very lengthy lesson on response surface methodology, My idea is to give the basics
okay.
of the smooth surface methodology, and then the students they can pick up
mm.
because it is not always taught everywhere.
Mm.
So once it is taught by the teachers, they will be able to pick up from the basics that I am going to give. Yeah, Sagarika, this module was a bit tricky as well as kind of comprehensive, that we had a list of defining sets, we had a list of key blocks, matching the two, getting one from the other, and then completing an incomplete description of the key block, subject to retaining, etc., etc. So this is a kind of comprehensive idea about confounding and blocking. The problem gets complicated when you talk in terms of four blocks instead of two blocks. So these are various issues coming up here. I hope and believe that with this exposure to the, mostly to the basics in factorial experiments, confounding, etc., you will be able to, if some higher level courses are offered, the students will be able to catch up and then start from here with a thorough understanding of the basics in this manner. I think this is going to be a good working exercise, good grounding for the students at the master's level. So for the next topic, as I said, next three modules will deal with response surface methodology. Sagarika, before we proceed to the next set of modules on response surface, let me take up some theoretical questions on whatever we have discussed in this. The question one reads like, mm-hmm. you have a 2 to the power 5 factorial experiment. It is laid out in 4 blocks of 8 plots each, and the key block starts with, etc., 1, A, B, A, B,
mm-hmm.
stops right there.
Mm-hmm.
Examine the feasibility of existence of one solution to the remaining 4 level combinations of the key block so as not to confound any main effect. Very interesting problem. The goal is to have a 4 block 2 to the power 5 factorial experiment,
mm-hmm.
thereby confounding 3 effects and interactions.
Okay.
The key block starts with 1, A, B, A, B.
Mm-hmm.
Now you have to fill up the rest.
Okay.
But you have to make sure that in doing so, you don't confound any main effect.
Okay.
You cannot just write arbitrarily
mm-hmm.
the remaining 4.
Mm-hmm.
You have to make sure that no main effect is confounded
okay.
while you try to extend these 4 level combinations to another 4 to make it 8.
Okay.
That's the this question, okay?
Mm-hmm.
The next question is similarly 2 to the power 5,
mm-hmm.
4 blocks,
mm-hmm.
and the experimenter started with 4 level combinations in the key block,
mm.
1, BC, D, BC, D, that's the generalized thing. Examine the feasibility so as not to confound any main effect. Same
okay.
type of question.
Mm.
This time the key block formation started in a different tone.
Mm.
You have to fill up the rest
mm.
to make sure that no main effect is confounded.
Okay.
And the third one is a 2 to the power 5 laid out
it
in 4 blocks,
nice.
4 level combinations. The
mm.
key block starts like A, A, B, C, something interesting to learn.
Okay.
The key block starts with, it says the block starts with, it does not say key block,
okay.
because you don't see one
here.
Yeah,
yes.
Now, the block starts with A, A, B, C, A, D, E, A, B, C, D, E.
Mm-hmm.
Examine the feasibility of existence of one solution to the remaining 4 level combinations of the key block so as not to confound any main effect. Let's try to understand this problem. It says 2 to the power 5,
mm.
4 blocks, every block will have 8, fine,
mm.
we know. And then suddenly it gives a block, not the complete block, but only 4
mm.
out of 8. It starts with A, A, B, C, A, D, E, A, B, C, D. We know in the formation of the 4 blocks, somewhere there is the key block,
mm.
even though they are not showing it.
Mm.
So can we drag and identify the key block from
yes.
this? We multiply all by A.
Mm.
That means 1. B, C, D, B, C, D.
Mm.
So the key block is hidden somewhere
mm.
and we can identify it starting from this block
mm.
by multiplying all the level combinations by A.
Mm.
That will mean 1, B, C, D, B, C, D.
Mm.
So it is as good as question number 2 now
mm.
because the key block is now formed of these 4 elements
mm.
and the question is can you extend it to make sure that no main effect is confounded. So even though in this problem you don't see the key block right away,
mm-hmm.
but you can reconstruct the key block
mm-hmm.
from the given
yes.
formation of the block.
Mm-hmm.
This is another block sitting here.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and once you do that, then you identify it as it is.
So here are some MCQs.
Okay, please read.
Okay.
Yeah.
The first one is with reference to question number one.
Okay.
In the exercises that we just discussed, the key block suggests that the interaction effect AB is likely to be confounded,
okay.
or the interaction effect CD is likely to be confounded, CDE
okay.
is likely to be confounded,
okay.
or it might be the interaction effect ABCDE is likely to be confounded.
Okay, can you go back?
Question number one.
Yeah. So question number one started with an incomplete description of the key block, namely 1ABAB. And in that question, they wanted to know whether one can complete the formation of the key block by appending four more level combinations so that not to confound any main effect. So that was one question here. Now, given 1AB and AB, and suppose you have completed the block, then you know how the block formation is going. Now they are asking this question, whether the interaction effect AB is likely to be confounded or CD or ABCD. We know what confounding of AB means. Confounding of AB would mean A minus 1, B minus 1. CD would mean C minus 1, D minus 1, E minus 1, along with A plus 1, B plus 1. Like that, we know each one. So once we do that, and then we see the formation of the composition of the blocks underlying confounding of AB or CDE or ABCDE, we can go back and match the formation of the key block over here and we can make a conclusion. Okay, it's a bit tricky but not at all difficult.
Yes.
Next one.
Now, with reference to question number two that we just discussed, the key block suggests that it's
a similar type of question.
Here is the third one.
Yes.
With reference to question number three in the exercise above, the key block suggests that the similar
what is the likely interaction to be confounded.
Yes, there are three options.
Right. And what is question number four?
Here we are referring to question number three again.
Three again, okay.
And here also the key block suggests that the interaction effect either ACD or ADE or BCD.
Okay, can you go back?
Yes.
We know the question number three and question number two, basically they are equivalent because starting with question number three, with the block formation as A, B, C, A, D, E, A, B, C, D, we tried to deconstruct the key block by multiplying all by A, and that gave us 1, B, C, D, B, C, D, which is the same as that in question 2. So once we have looked at question number 2, and we know how the block formation is going and what are the likely interaction effects to be confounded, we can resolve question 3.